Hi, and welcome to our ninth video where we are building our DevSecOps pipeline with GitHub. Hey, Padi. In our past videos, we had so many vulnerabilities, and we also could see all these findings in the security tab. How do we manage these vulnerability findings?
Good question, and actually that's the topic of this video. As mentioned, we've done already a lot kind of figuring out what vulnerabilities we have. We've done everything from software composition analysis down to secret detection, including automated penetration testing, which is dynamic application security testing, and so on. So we found a lot of vulnerabilities, and now the question is, how do we actually manage them? This is where the GitHub security tab comes into play. When we click on the security tab, we can go from there to code scanning or secret scanning. In the code scanning part, we have all vulnerabilities found by tools in our pipeline, by tools that we selected. In the secret scanning section, we see all security vulnerabilities or findings of the GitHub provided secret scanning tool. Vulnerabilities are tracked on all the branches where our pipeline run and where the tools have been executed. Most important, obviously, are those branches that are close to production. The capabilities provided by GitHub are the following. We can sort and filter by tool, branch, criticality, and even by rule, although that's not very valuable. We can also create issues from a finding, which means we can create developer tasks or analysis tasks out of security vulnerabilities our tools found. For all the findings, we can assess them and either dismiss them as false positive, which means it doesn't apply here, it's a false finding. We can say it's a won't fix, so basically we say it's a risk we accept and we won't change anything in our code, we just live with this vulnerability. Or we can mark it as test code only, which means it's not production code, it's just used within test code we've written. For all of this, and this is very valuable, we can provide a description giving the details why we decided to go for one or the other. Because all the vulnerabilities are automatically marked as resolved as soon as we actually have resolved them, so they go away in the vulnerability view, there's no capability of stating explicitly issue resolved. We can also integrate additional tools, basically security tools, as long as they deliver their finding report in the so-called serif format.
But Padi, this sounds quite good for a vulnerability management. What are the limitations of GitHub?
You're right, it's quite a good start, but there are limitations. First of all, you cannot dismiss a finding for a limited time. Now, why is this even important? It's important because for some security findings, you just want to have them go away for the moment. So you say basically, yeah, for the next 2 weeks or for the next 2 months, it's acceptable. Or as of now, there is no solution for that at all. So I just postpone it to kind of release or resolve them a bit later. And this is why we actually need the capability to dismiss for a limited time, but we don't have that. On top of that, we also cannot change the severity that's given by the tool. So if the tool says, well, it's rated as a high finding, then it remains a high finding. Although maybe after analysis, I figure out, well, in our special case, it's not a high finding because we have other compensating measures and we should reduce the severity to medium or low. But as said, we can't do that. What's always the case is that we need some manual effort to review the findings. There will be false positives, there might be duplicates, and so on. But this is inherent in the process, so that's part of always happening, so nothing special for GitHub. Another limitation is that GitHub requires the serif format in order to import vulnerabilities in its database. That's not too much or not too grave a limitation because it's at least a standardized format. Yet what I really hate is that it's not possible to add manual entries. So say I kind of give an external penetration tester the job to penetration test my application and he finds 10 new vulnerabilities. Now I would want to add these vulnerabilities to this vulnerability management tool in GitHub, but I can't. So this means I always have to have another vulnerability management tool for vulnerabilities found outside the platform. Grave limitation. I'm back now in our project, so let's see where it is, the security vulnerability management. It's in security tab, and then in the lower left part, I have code scanning and secret scanning. I'll start with secret scanning. In here, we now have all the findings that the secret scanning tool that's built into GitHub found for us. I can filter by secret type, which in our case is only Azure Storage as of now, by provider, which is only the integrated one, and I can give a sorting order. That's basically okay. Such a vulnerability finding or a secret that's found is displayed as follows. Beside the title, we have a reference to the secret it found and some recommendation regarding how to remediate all this. All of this is quite nice and we know really what the problem is. So let's close that section and head over to the other part of vulnerability management. By the way, why they decided to kind of provide different user interfaces for secret scanning and code scanning, I do not know. I expect it to be because secret scanning is integrated into the platform and considered something special and that requires extra effort and extra steps when we find a problem there. So we go to code scanning now and we immediately see that we have a number of open issues here and we have the same capability to filter by tool, by branch where it happened, as well as by rule, which doesn't provide too much value, except if you know you're looking for a specific vulnerability, or by severity. Now let's see what problems we have in our own code. For this, we filter for CodeQL. Then if I take a look at the use of broken or risky cryptography, we find our MD5 instance here again, which we already assessed and we know, no, it's not really a finding. We use that just for indexing, for example. So what I can do is I can dismiss this guy as a false positive or as won't fix, whatever matches better your process description. In our case, I will say it's a false positive and as a command git, I give is just for indexing and dismiss this alert. Let me head back. Now I just have one open issue for my CodeQL tool And I see that there exists already two closed ones. So I could also filter on these and see them that I already resolved. Back to the open one. So let's open the cross-site scripting issue we also found. That's because the message here is returned to the caller and that's also inserted here, so it's reflected cross-site scripting. That's a real issue. What shall I do with that? Let me create an issue for that so that a developer gets a task within GitHub. For this, I can simply click on Create Issue, provide some additional description if I want to, and submit this new issue. What we see here that we changed view to the issues section and we opened directly the new issue we created. We see that it's nicely tracked here. So this issue tracks actually this finding. If I click on that finding, I'm back in the security tab and my finding has opened here for further analysis. On the other hand, we see in that area that this finding is already tracked by an issue here. Or if I scroll further down, here we see the history of this vulnerability. So we first detected it back in November. Then it was on a branch. We fixed it in a branch. It reappeared in a branch and so on. So pretty nice what we can get out of here. And I said also that it's tracked with this issue here. I'm now on my issue. I'll jump over to the vulnerability description. So I open the file from here, where I get all the context information, the whole file view. And in order to edit it, I change to the branch where I want to fix that. For simplicity, I just take the main branch. Next, I can click on Edit. And then fix the issue here. And I save. Let's head over to the actions. We see that the main pipeline was run, everything executed. Then jump to the security tab and see whether it actually figured out that there should be one less vulnerability. Go to code scanning and when selecting the tool again, CodeQL, we saw that it has zero open vulnerabilities, which means before we had one, so we actually resolved that. If I go to see the closed, then we see that we have it here 4 minutes ago. We solve this cross-site scripting issue. Remember that we also assigned a new issue for that one, which was this one. If I head over here, then we see that it's still open, so I still have to close that manually. While this is not optimal, it's arguable that it's also okay-ish, so to say that in a regular workflow, the developer is fixing the issue, can close it here also if he thinks it's good, and then the scanner will kind of provide proof that it really is gone. So I just close it here.
So we just saw the vulnerability management of GitHub. We just saw that the whole vulnerability management is in the security tab. There we have two options, the code scanning, where all of our scanning results of our tools are placed, and the secret scanning where we have the GitHub secret scanning in there. We saw that we can create an issue out of a vulnerability finding, and that we also can flag them as won't fix, false positive, or used in test. Overall, the vulnerability management of GitHub is not too bad, but what we definitely miss is that we can create our own vulnerability, which are outside of GitHub found. This can be, for example, when we are doing an external penetration test. And with that, we're at the end of this video. In our next video, we'll have a look at branch protection.